I've heard so many scary stories from different professions, I figured I could share my own. I'll start out by describing my area and the history for a little background. I'm in the southeastern United States. We have lots of Civil War battlegrounds and trackside graves, etc. There's an area just south of Nashville called Chapel Hill, Tennessee. The story is, at night around midnight you can see the light of an old school swinging lantern with a headless corpse carrying it, walking down the tracks. The corpse of a man who was once a conductor who was decapitated after falling off a moving train. Our locomotive cabs have three seats in them: left, conductor, center, extra/brakeman, and right, engineer. I got called on a two-man crew to run the Chapel Hill line. We rolled into the town at about 11:50 p.m., and out of nowhere we went into emergency. My conductor goes to walk the train, leaving me alone in the cab. After about 10 minutes all of my lights go out and come back on, and I see a figure standing on the tracks in front of our stopped train. Thinking it was my conductor, I leave my seat and go out the cab door to see what's wrong. I get on the ground to see nobody around anywhere. I was freaked the fuck out at this point, so I just got back on and sat down. At this point I looked in my rearview mirrors and saw a figure moving on my second unit, second locomotive. I radioed my conductor asking where he was, just to hear that he was 30 cars back from me. I walked to the second unit just to find nothing. At this point I'm frustrated and creeped out and basically stranded in this nowhere town on a haunted stretch of tracks. I go back to the lead locomotive, a few minutes pass. I feel like I'm being watched, so I turn to the left to see a corpse with no head rising out of the conductor's seat coming at me. I'm frozen with fear at this point. Right as it gets within a few feet of me, it just disappeared. I then saw a lantern swing moving away from my train. My conductor happened to see it on his way back and asked why I was outside with my lantern. I explained what happened as we got back on our way, but fuck, that was a freaky night. That's the only story I have time to post right now. I'll have more later.
Hello YouTube. Dan Rails and Dales here, and you're here for story time. But before we begin today's story, I would like to ask that you subscribe, like this video, and comment your likes and dislikes about this video and or this series. Before we begin, turn your lights off, sit down, cozy up, and don't mind that noise you just heard downstairs. Are you ready? Scary Stories from a Railroad are part 2. Being in this career, you see many things the average 9-to-5 worker doesn't see. One night, just outside of a little town in southern Middle Tennessee called Tullahoma, we were traveling doing about 60 miles an hour. Just to set the scene a little better, it was around 2:30 a.m. The rural area, along with the nothing but the sound of your locomotive, can be somewhat eerie. As we came over a hill onto a bit of flat land, I could vaguely see the lights of a car racing for the upcoming road crossing. At 60 miles an hour, you're on something before you know it. I'm blowing my horn way more than the normal, two longs, a short, and a long through the crossing. I gave all I could. The car didn't stop. They always told me don't make eye contact with the person you're about to hit. I've also been told during moments of extreme emotional duress, you remember things in great detail. The split second of fear in her eyes was traumatizing. She was the most beautiful dark-haired, blue-eyed beauty in a black dress I'd ever seen. They say real beauty is on the inside. I must disagree, because the brain matter on my locomotive plow looked nothing near as good as the woman that once possessed it. Hello, YouTube. And Rails and Tales coming back at you with Scary Stories from a Railroader Volume 3. Before we begin our story though, I would like to ask that you like this video, comment what you like or dislike about this video or the series, subscribe to my channel if you're not already subscribed, and hit that notification bell so you know the first second I post new content. Now, turn the lights off, sit down, cozy up, and don't mind that noise you just heard downstairs. Are you ready? Scary Stories from a Railroader, Volume 3. This experience happened on the previous division I worked on. I worked the 110-mile main line between Kingsport, Tennessee and Shelby, Kentucky. This route goes to the Appalachian Mountains and also passes through the coal fields and mines that once had the area's dead economy booming. This is now one of the poorest areas in America. You often see almost unlivable shacks with families along the tracks. When I was a young blood, the old heads and locals told me the folklore and tales of the mountain. Just figured I was getting hay since I'd now been here 15 years and had never seen any of it. Well, until now. I got called for a train out of Kingsport for 9 p.m. I arrived at the yard office around 8:30 p.m. and greeted my conductor. He was just out of training and this is going to be his first trip. His name was Chris, and after a short conversation, I thought I'd like working with him. We boarded the locomotive, and by 9:30 we were given the track warrants and green light to leave. I notched the throttle back and let her eat. As an engineer, you have to be constantly aware of your surroundings. After leaving, I noticed a little movement in the second unit. Damn hobos, I said. We ended up having to take siding just before going into Virginia and meet another train. I took the opportunity to investigate the movement in the second unit. I turned on the locomotive cab lights and looked around. Engineer seat, clear. Conductor seat, clear. At a random bodily urge, I went to the engine bathroom to piss. I unzipped my pants and opened the door to find a 25-year-old young man huddled on the ground shivering. It was the middle of winter, December 23rd to be exact. I got him up, showed him how to work the heater, sat him down. He was just trying to get to Big Stone Gap, Virginia for Christmas. I said, well, you're in luck. We'll slow down and see him get off there. He smiled and thanked me, and I went back to the lead unit because we had been given the green light to leave. We were going through the most rural areas of the route from this point on. It takes a strong mind to do this. The loneliness, the nighttime silence only being broken by your conductor's voice calling signals, and the miles of open track and darkness can get to a weak person. Around 3 a.m. we were approaching Natural Tunnel. All this is a 2-mile-long cave the railroad built track through. A lot of Indians were killed on these hillsides as the railroad built through here. As we went through the Natural Tunnel, our mid-train power locomotive lost radio contact with the lead engine. This put unneeded stress on the couplers, causing the train to split in half. We put the train in emergency. Once we fully stopped, we determined the train needed to be walked. Normally the conductor would go alone, but Chris was scared. I decided to walk with Chris, and we walked by the light of his lantern. Our train was 2 miles long. We found the broken knuckle, coupler for you non-railroaders, about halfway. We fixed the knuckle and I had to leave Chris to return to the locomotive for the reverse recoupling maneuver. I was about 3/4 of the way back to the lead unit before Chris radioed me asking me where I was. I told him, and I got no response, but I proceeded on. I got on the engine and got ready to make the move, so I radioed Chris letting him know I was ready. After about 4 minutes with no response, I repeated myself. After another 2 or 3 minutes, I figured the signal came and went in the cave for our radios. A radio dispatch telling them what happened and to be on standby. I grabbed my flashlight and started making my way back towards Chris. Once I got inside of his lantern, I called to him with a loud echo off the cave walls. All of a sudden, I saw Chris's body go flying between the cars and broken couplers. And he hit the cave with a loud thud. He slid to the ground as my attention was drawn back to the area he was launched from. Some thing was standing there, and it must have been 8 to 10 feet tall. Its head turned towards me with the reddest glowing eyes I'd ever seen. As soon as it made eye contact with me, it let out the slow, guttural, gut-wrenching growl. He stomped, stomped, stomped. It continued to gain on me. The engine was in sight, so I gave everything I had. I dived for the grab irons and the steps. Caught them, I scurried into the cab and I locked the doors. I looked around the windows and I saw nothing. I radioed dispatch in a panic and told them what happened, though I was barely audible.
They told me to proceed with what I had left of train to Big Stone Gap, and authorities and another engineer would be there to relieve me. I put the throttle in run 8 full throttle. As soon as I stepped off the engine, my legs came out from under me. They were just jello, and I fell to the ground. As the EMTs tended to me, I looked up at the second unit and saw those same red glowing eyes at the window that I'd seen before. I passed out after that. I was awoken in the hospital by a very inquisitive detective. He explained to me that they could only identify Chris with dental records. Chris had been mauled so bad they didn't have any animal on record that attacked in that manner. My brain had shut most of it out at the time, so I was useless to the case. As the detective left, he stopped and turned towards me and said, "Oh yeah, Mr. T and Rails and Tills, do you know anything about the dead 25-year-old we found in the second unit? We found him with his chest plate broken and his ribs split open from the center." I passed out after that gruesome detail again. Come to find out, a few track workers and hobos that had had family that knew their last whereabouts and cared enough to report them missing disappeared in the same area. I was eventually able to get past all this and go back to work. About a week after returning, I was sitting in the Kingsport locker room. An old head sat down beside me and said, "You must be lucky. Not many survive a Wendigo the first time." I transferred divisions a week later. Okay guys, that's our story for this week. I really hope you enjoyed that. And we'll have another one coming at you next Saturday. Oh yeah, one more thing guys. Like I said in the beginning of the video, hit that like button, subscribe to my channel, share this video to all your friends that want to be a little creeped out, and hit the notification bell so you're aware the second that I release new content. Thank you guys. We'll see you guys every Saturday around 4 p.m. Hopefully we'll be able to get back on the rail soon. But until then, enjoy the scary stories. Welcome, friends. Tonight's story takes us to the darkest part of the hills of Tennessee. I would also like to ask that you like this video, subscribe to my channel if you're not already subscribed, and hit that notification bell so you know the second I put new content out. Now, turn the lights out, sit down, cozy up, and don't mind that noise you just heard downstairs. Are you ready? Scary Stories from a Railroader, Volume 4, The Dark Hills of Tennessee. This story happened when I was working the 150-mile line between Nashville and Chattanooga, Tennessee. I was working on a local run called the Cowan Pusher. With the mountain grade starting at Cowan and basically going all the way to Chattanooga, it can be a difficult stretch of railroad. I had the third shift on the Cowan Pusher. It was all I could hold even if I didn't enjoy working nights. We basically just sat in the shop and waited to be called to help heavy tonnage trains get to Sherwood, Tennessee. Now all I can say about Sherwood is picture the hills have eyes, but add banjos. On the night in question, it was about 11:50 p.m. when a heavy freight train stopped over at Sherwood and requested our help. We climbed on the engines and got on our way. By the time we hit South Cowan and started curving up the foot of the mountain, we had no visibility of anything that wasn't illuminated by the locomotive light. We had a 30-minute ride ahead of us, along with a 2-mile-long dark tunnel in our path. As the clock struck midnight, we were now in the middle of nowhere, surrounded by woods, filled with wolves, rattlesnakes, and a few mountain folks. Most of the mountain folk are nice, but don't let the sun set on your ass in those woods. About 10 minutes later, the north portal of the tunnel was in sight. A bridge overhung the entrance. A branch line that was taken up long ago crossed over it to go to another part of the mountains. The bridge is still accessible by ATV. As I looked up, I saw a campfire and people. They all looked to be dressed darkly, maybe even in masks. All I could see was white in the faces. As we started under the bridge, we heard a thud over our heads on the locomotive roof. We proceeded through the dark tunnel and slowed just out of the south portal as the conductor looked out the back door with his flashlight. He saw nothing, so we shrugged our shoulders and proceeded on the last 10 minutes to our waiting train. It was 12:20 a.m. as we coupled onto the rear of the train to push it from Sherwood. As the engineer on the head end entered the south portal of the tunnel, he radioed back to me, talking about figures standing over the entrance. However, no one was there as it came in my sight. As we exited the north portal, I looked to the best I could see on my side of the tracks for whatever had hit our roof. I saw what looked like a black cloak fluttering in the wind as we passed, but I really couldn't tell. As we entered Callan, we uncoupled on the fly and the train continued on to Nashville. We cruised into our parking track and tied our engines down. As we got off, we had the feeling of being watched, but we thought nothing of it, and we went and parked our asses in the office chairs. We had no more work for the rest of our shift. We talked and napped, on and off, till about 3 a.m. We never did shake the feelings of being watched. So we stepped outside as I put a pinch of dip in my lip and my conductor lit a cigarette. As we both bullshitted with each other, we noticed movement in the brush across the tracks. Now I must remind all of you that both my conductor and myself are big country boys and we don't scare easy. We went over to investigate. We found three hooded men in the bushes. With a huge spit of my tobacco, I asked them, "What the fuck do you guys think you're doing here? You understand you're trespassing on railroad property, right?" The lead guy then spoke up in a demonic, gravelly tone.
"We just want what's ours."
We looked to see a young man on the roof of the locomotive at the air horn. The young man was in nothing but underwear, and as we all looked at him, he bolted off the roof and climbed down and ran down the tracks. As this happened, the figures turned to chase. The lead guy then turned his head back towards us with glowing eyes that we can now see. He stared for seconds that felt like minutes. Then he gave chase with his friends. We called the police. After hours of investigation, they found the man's underwear. No traces of him or cloaked individuals. We even took them up to the mountain. Cops love free train rides. There was nothing. Now on occasion we find dead animals by the shop door, locomotive mutilated. I've even found one or two at my door at home. We still occasionally see that fire on the bridge and get the feeling of being watched. But it's all gone by the time we return. There's a cult somewhere on that mountain. Alright guys, that's our story for tonight. I hope you enjoyed. Hope you got a little freaked out. But that's all I got, and I will see you guys next Saturday. Thanks, guys.